A pleasant afternoon to all of you. It's nice to be gathered together in this house of worship to feel God's presence and to be blessed. This is our last afternoon session for this week of prayer, and we have another morning session tomorrow and a session during the Vespers meeting, and the last and the culmination of our week of prayer will be on the Sabbath. And so I would like to request everyone to prepare ourselves for the communion service this coming Sabbath. The lady beside me, this young lady, is her first time to attend our week of prayer since she graduated last 2009. Ma'am Diane, what are God's impressions to you for this week of prayer?
Well, Ma'am, I remember in my college days, week of prayer is one of my favorite or most awaited event in the campus, because there's always a blessing whenever I attend the week of prayer. God always speaks to my heart whatever things He wants to cleanse me from. And for this week of prayer, as I listen to the messages from God's Word, from the different experiences of the people who encountered Jesus in their lives, I was impressed and encouraged that God is really working in each of our hearts. And I believe that is true with every one of us here.
Okay, thank you, Ma'am Diane. And I know that is the same experience with you, especially to our young people. Let me share with you some quotations from the writings or from the books of Mrs. White, Counsels on Health, page 422, Steps to Christ, page 101, and from the book A New Life, page 6. Please listen to this carefully. No soul can prosper without time to pray, to search the scriptures, and all should, as far as possible, have the privilege of attending public worship. We sustain a loss when we neglect the privilege of associating together to strengthen and encourage one another in the service of God. If Christians would associate together, speaking to each other of the love of God and of the precious fruits of redemption, their own hearts would be refreshed and they would refresh one another. Whenever the Word of God has been faithfully preached, results have followed that Spirit of God accompanied the message of His servants, and the Word was with power.
May we refrain from anything that will hinder us to worship God in spirit and in truth.
May God bless us all today.
A blessed afternoon to everyone. Shall we all stand and sing our theme song?
Thank you, Paul.
Oh,
Good afternoon, children of God. Have you been blessed by the messages of this week? Can I get an amen for that?
Amen.
Amen. For our prayer time this afternoon, I will be orienting you for the sequence of our prayer. The praise team will be opening a song, and after that, you will be given 2 to 3 minutes to pray. And after that, there will be a song that will be sung by our praise team, and I will give the concluding prayer. Before I pray, I'll be reading from the Review and Herald. We cannot depend upon form or external machinery. What we need is the quickening influence of the Holy Spirit of God, not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. Pray without ceasing, and watch by working in accordance with your prayers. As you pray, believe, trust in God. It is the time of the latter rain, when the Lord will give largely of His Spirit. Be fervent in prayer, and watch in the Spirit. May we please kneel down.
Thank you.
Our Father in heaven, O Lord, we praise you for once again. We can come to you in prayer. We praise you, dear God, for leading us into this place of worship. May you please fill our hearts, O Lord, with joy and peace as we approach your throne of grace. May your Holy Spirit overflow in our lives. And dear God, I would like to ask for forgiveness of our sins. We may hurt other people's feelings through our words or deeds, but we ask for forgiveness, O Lord. Please remove our unrighteousness so we may be receptive of your words. I would like to lift your servant, Miriam Fautagana. May you please hide her behind the cross, so only you and you alone will be glorified and will be seen. And may you please let the Holy Spirit work through her, as well as the congregation, so we may be receptive of your words. We thank you, O Lord, for the grace and mercy that we received this week. And we also thank you for your love and for all the overflowing blessings we receive. We thank you, O Lord, for everything you have done into our lives. This we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Good afternoon, PAC. Good afternoon. Amen. In the College of Business, we understand that promotion is a method that an organization or a business uses to make the customer aware of its product and its service. And we also learn that a product and a service is something that is promoted because it satisfies and it meets the need of the customer. And so I stand in front of you this afternoon to be a promoter from my father's business of a product or of a service that I know for sure that it can satisfy and it meets your spiritual need. And I know for sure that I guarantee you that this is without a price. It's free for everyone, and that I want to promote you the United Prayer. Personally, I've been so much blessed by the United Prayer. The reason behind was that the fact that I've experienced who really Jesus is. In United Prayer, Jesus taught me that he himself don't choose whom he wanted to be saved. I repeat, Jesus don't choose whom he wanted to be saved. It's for everyone. Everyone who kneels down in prayer, everyone, whether who you are, what position you occupy, who you are, whatever you are, just come boldly as you are. And God is in no wise will cast you out. And I believe that everyone who kneels down in prayer, not even one amongst them, God wants to perish. And that's what I want to boast about United Prayer. United Prayer, and let us experience the love of God, the love that saves, the love that rescues, the love that lifts us up from sin. And that's obviously because amongst those people who gathers in prayer, God is in the midst of them. Evidence, I want to read to you from the Step to Christ book, chapter 11, page 93. I hope it's been projected. Paragraph 2. In Steps to Christ, chapter 11, page 93, paragraph 2, it says, prayer does not bring God down to us, but prayer brings us up to him. And so could you just imagine? We only have to kneel down and we can be assured that we can unite earth to heaven. Amen? And it's so very nice to imagine that it's only have to kneel down in prayer so that we can be assured of God's presence. And so right now, I'm encouraging you, if you really want to have a full experience of His presence, in His presence, AUP's spiritual conference, please come and join us in the United Prayer. And I know for sure that it's not about how articulate and eloquent you become in prayer, or it's not about how beautiful your words are, but I believe what matters most is how sincere your heart to God is. And so, and I believe as well that out of the abundance of heart, the mouth speaks. And so I'm Joanna, and I just want to tell you that God is calling you and is inviting you to please come and join us in the United Prayer tomorrow morning at 6 a.m. to 7 a.m. and it continues to 3 to 4 p.m. And that's all. May we see you there. May God bless you.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Let's try it once again. I think you're quite distracted by how I look. Let's try it again. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm very happy to see you in the fourth to the last session of this week of prayer. Can you believe it? Week of prayer is about to end. And so as we begin our session this afternoon, I just want to share this quotation, this powerful quotation found in the Great Controversy, page 518, paragraph 3. And I please beg each one of you to read with me. The scripture declares that upon one occasion, when the angels of God came to present themselves before the Lord, Satan came also among them, not to bow before the eternal King, but to further his malicious designs against the righteous. With the same object, he is in what? Attendance when men assemble for the worship of God. Though hidden from sight, he is working with all diligence to control the minds of the worshipers. Like a skillful general, he lays his plans beforehand. Before we even go to PIC this afternoon, Satan already has his plan. As he sees the messenger of God searching the scriptures, he takes notes of the subject to be presented to the people. Then he employs all his cunning and shrewdness so to control circumstances that the message may not reach those whom he is deceiving on that very point. The one who most needs the warning will be urged into some business transaction, hearing the words that might prove to him a savior of life and to life. And so, dear friends, this afternoon, the enemy came uninvited. And if we are going to SAO right now and checked on his attendance for week of prayer, his grade will be excellent. Excellent compared to every one of us. Because you know what? He doesn't want to miss his opportunity right now to distract even one person, to cause somebody right now to sleep. Or probably somebody text you so that you will not hear the words of the Lord. Or probably use you as a distraction to your seatmate. And so at this very moment, I plead with you, please be in the spirit of prayer. Pray for yourself and pray for me. For the devil is like a roaring lion, roaming around PIC right now, seeking someone he may devour, seeking someone he can eat for dinner. Please bow your heads with me as I pray. Almighty Father in heaven, we are in your presence right now. We don't seek for any performance, for any applause, for any self-exaltation, but you only seek, dear Lord, to worship you. And I praise you so much, dear Heavenly Father, for in your presence, all of us are equal. I am no less than in need of a Savior as much as my dear friends here. And so I beg with you, dear Lord, you know me very well. I am just a little girl who desires to just sit in your feet, at your feet, and not speak. But Lord, I praise you and I claim your presence right now, that when you call someone, you will equip, and that you have answered so many prayers at this very moment, that truly your presence will be thick in this place, and every one of us will experience your presence, will experience you right at your feet. Please, dear Heavenly Father, lift yourself up on high right now, and please draw each and every one of us closer to Jesus. Please hear our prayers, and may your name alone will be glorified through me. For these I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So I have a question for you this afternoon. What is your favorite place in the whole world? Please think for a while. What's your favorite place in the whole world? I asked five persons from AUP what is their most favorite place? And here are their answers. Mom Sarian Definio said that her favorite place is on top of a mountain or on a mountain peak. Another person, Richard Estores, a dentistry student, said that he loves the Twin Tower in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. And another friend said she didn't go further from AUP. Her favorite place is right there in the Centennial Park, where she can spend time with the Lord and commune with nature. And another friend said that she has been to many places already, but nothing compares to her home. And I believe most of us can relate to this. Kay Gara, a nursing student, said that her favorite place is on her bed. Can you relate? Yes. All right. If you would ask me right now, I only have one answer for each of you. My favorite place, at someone's feet. At someone's feet. Yes, you've heard it right. That feet have walked so many miles. He walked over the sea. He walked over the lands. And he even walked the road to Calvary just so he could reach me. Just so he could reach you. Just so he could reach every one of us. My story can be found in John 8, 1-11, Mark 14, 3-9, Matthew 26, 6-13. And I would like to recommend you that book, At Jesus' Feet, so you can read more my story. I am Mary Magdalene, and this is my story, At Jesus' Feet. I actually grew up in a Jewish family in Bethany, near Jerusalem, where the grandiose temple is. There in Bethany, in my family, I learned the story of creation. How Adam and Eve fell from sin. The story of Noah and the flood. The 40-year sojourn of the Israelites, and how the Lord has been faithful to them despite their faithlessness and unfaithfulness. And who would not remember the story of David and Goliath? All of these stories I've known from child. I went to church, I went to mission trips, but everything became a routine for me. I long for something real, something more authentic than what I see. The holiness, the facade of holiness that I see with everybody all around me, bored and drained me off. I long for something. I longed for someone who can define to me what true love is. And so I left Bethany, I went to Magdala, hoping that there I'll be able to experience the real meaning of love. What is really love? And so I went to Magdala. I am living the life that I always dreamt of. And so I thought. I started to gain a lot of friends who went out to party almost every night. And I met a lot of handsome guys. And they're not just handsome. They also have this. They have the money. And so slowly, with all the enjoyment that I am living, I am experiencing in Magdala, I started slowly and unconsciously, I started to compromise. And with each little compromise, I thought I'll be able to gain a foothold on the truth that I have learned back home. But I was totally wrong. With each compromise that I made, I felt more empty. I felt that my life has no meaning and has no purpose. And so I thought, I'll just double whatever things I'm doing so that it can feel the emptiness that is growing inside my heart. But I don't know what happened. Few months, one by one, my so-called friends left me. One by one, they left me alone. I lose my job. I lose my home. I have nowhere else to go. And so I started to live a promiscuous life. I became a prostitute. But still inside my heart, I still have that longing to know what does love really means. Man after another man, I felt as horrible as I have been. I have never felt as horrible as I have been in this life. Compromise upon compromise, and it only left me empty, empty, and more empty. And you know, my dear friends, that is actually the nature of sin. Sin is something that will eat you up alive. One movie, one time that we said yes to smoke or drink, one Sabbath that you didn't go to church, one thought, negative thought that you entertain about yourself and about others, one time that you followed your heart, and you and your sweetheart did something that only married couples should do. Name all those one time that led into another, that led into another, and soon enough, you think you are just too sinful for the Lord to forgive you. You think that, why would I come to God? I know I have this tendency to go back to that sin again. I am just too sinful. And you know what? That is actually the lie of the enemy. One early morning, something happened that totally changed my life forever. It was like an empty canvas where an artist will paint a beautiful picture. It's like an empty sheet of paper that a musician will write to make a harmonious, a melodious piece of music. I was right there in the outskirts of Jerusalem, right outside of Jerusalem. I was doing my usual business when suddenly, early in the morning, somebody knocked on my door. It was a man. It was a man. He offered me triple of what I usually offer. Triple of what I usually ask for. And so I gave in. I gave in to what he said. And the next thing I heard early in that morning, yeah, grab her! As the door of my house opened and it made a loud thud across on the wall opposite that door. I was frightened, my heart froze, and I thought that the day I most feared has come. The day I most feared has come. Prostitute, adulterer, the rabbis and priests shouted at me. And some of them, you know what? I can recognize as my former clients. But to identify them right that time is to intensify my impending judgment. My customers sleep beneath my sheets, giving me a sheepish shrug. And I thought, this is a trap. I should have stayed in Magdala. This is a trap. I stood up on my feet and I struggled, trying to escape. But the clutches of the guards are too overpowering for me. I cannot escape. And I just trembled, my whole body trembled because of fear. One of them said, let us just bring her like that, naked, to the temple. It will be more convincing to everybody who will see her. But then one scribe said, we cannot bring her like that to the temple. And so one of them saw a crumpled and dirty robe. He took it and threw it at me. I snatched it immediately and covered my nakedness. Thankful even for that crude covering. I was still trembling. I was still trembling. And at the command of one older scribe, they pulled me out of the door. They dragged me to the streets, and their muscular fingers bruising my olive skin and my long, splendid hair, my pride and glory fell tangled over my face. I struggled to maintain my footing over the rocks. Where are they taking me, I thought. Where are they taking me? Up ahead, loomed the holy temple. The holy temple. They are taking me to the temple. And I could hear the shouts and the curses from spectators as we pass. Curious housewives the merchants, they're following us in the procession. And that moment, out of fear and out of desperation, I did something that I never did for so long in my life. I prayed. I prayed, Lord, please don't let someone see me right now as I am. Please save me from this. I don't want to die. Please forgive me from all my sins. But then I remember, why would the Holy Son of God forgive someone such as I? How can He forgive me from what I did in the past? We continued walking, and I noticed that the priests and the mob started to pick up something. They started to pick up the large rock on the side of the streets. They're going to stone me. They're going to stone me to death. And then I saw agitated dogs following the procession. They're going to stone me. And they were going, and these dogs were going to eat me alive, as they did Jezebel. I was horrified. I was so afraid. And as the nosy spectators increased in number, I noticed somebody amidst the mob. Can you think who is that somebody? Do you have any guess? I noticed somebody in the mob holding a large rock as if any time he is going to throw the rock upon me. And you know who is that person? That person is the latest customer that I had. That person holding that big rock trying to stone me is my latest customer. Isn't, dear friends, isn't the devil like that? He will do something. He will ask us to do something. And at the end, when we already done that sin, he will turn around at first as if he is our companion, he is our friend. But after doing that, he will turn back on us, condemn us, and say, oh, you're too good, you're too bad, you can never be forgiven by the Lord. He entices us to sin. And after asking us to sin, he then stands by to accuse and condemn you. My mind raced that time. My trembling increased. My breath came in short gasps. Spots danced around my eyes. I felt as if I were in a tunnel and thought any time I might faint. I asked the guard beside me, why are they bringing me to the temple? And he told me that they are not actually after me. They are actually after the teacher. The teacher. I heard about the teacher who went abroad doing good and blessing everyone. And they told me that if they would be able to stone the teacher, probably they would give me my freedom. And soon I saw above the crowd of curious spectators, feast worshippers, and swirling dust, the white wall of God's sanctuary, gleaming golden in the early morning sunlight. A cool breeze shuffled my long hair, and I shivered. I don't know which frightened me more, the thought of being stoned to death or the thought of being paraded half naked into the sanctuary of God. And with renewed determination, we headed to the temple, when suddenly a young woman pulled my veil and then screeched on my face, called me a harlot, and hurled a well-aimed missile of saliva right in my already dirty robe. From that time on, I was reminded of how filthy, how sinful, how broken I am. And that's one thing I learned in life, my dear friends. Satan will employ every means to make us remember our sins. He will do everything for you to remember your sins, but not the Savior. In Steps to Christ 31, paragraph 3, it says here, it's a beautiful, beautiful quotation. If you see your sinfulness, do not wait to make yourself what? Better. How many there are who think they are not good enough to come to Christ? Do you expect to become better through your own efforts? Can the Ethiopians change his skin or the leopards his spots? Then maybe you also do good that are accustomed to evil. There is help for us only in God. Have you been there, dear friends, when you were asked to pray, but then you said no because you just so feel unworthy to even pray? Luke 53, Matthew 18, 11 says, "For the Son of Man is come to save that which was already saved." No, for the Son of Man is come to save that which was lost. And Luke 53, 32 says, "I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." We have hope in the Lord, my dear friends. And if you think we can fix ourselves, if you're thinking that, I will just clean myself up before I come to the Lord, then there's no need of a Savior. And every time we think that we can make ourselves better, it is like talking to God and saying, "Lord, you shouldn't have died on the cross because it has no value for me. I can clean myself. I can forgive myself." We are telling the Lord, "Lord, you shouldn't have died right there on the cross. Your sacrifice has no value." And so I would like to tell you, dear friends, stop looking on ourselves, but only turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and all these things, your sin, your incapabilities, your ugliness that nobody even knew about, will go strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. As we go back to the story, inside the courtyard, the atmosphere drastically changed. The familiar bleating of the goats and sheep, the cooing of the quail, and even the barnyard smell that every worshiper experienced when they come to the house of God were missing. Instead, there was a sweet air of peace and silent awe. Without warning, the guards slowed down their pace and then stopped. The priest leading the procession pointed to a crowd and said, "He is there. He is there." They straightened themselves and regained their arrogant, pious composure. And as our procession moved toward the heart of the crowd, the people parted for them to pass. We continued on walking. Until we stood before the one who was obviously the center of the gathering. I stared in awe, although I have heard of him, everybody has, but I have never seen such a man. His features were angular, ragged, not stranger to hard work or outdoor living, yet in his countenance, gentleness and expression of innocence mixed with wisdom and dignity were combined. His whole frame had a perfect symmetry of balance that bore a combination of nobility and compassion. I have never seen such majesty in any man I had known. And I have known many men in my life. For some strange reason I couldn't identify, I felt a sense of peace and security in the presence of that person. Surrounded by a wall of onlookers making escape impossible, the guard lose their grip on me, and I collapse, trembling at Jesus' feet. I close my eyes and I folded my arms over my head. Above the dean, unable to look at the holy man and thinking that maybe his nightmare go away. And above the din of shouts and mocking, I heard my accusers present before Jesus their lethal charge against me. Teacher, this woman was caught in adultery in the very act. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what do you say? The reality of my hopelessness and mortifying situation crushed me. The terrifying array of emotions caused me to lose consciousness briefly. No one noticed that I fainted except Jesus. No one saw me as I am except Jesus. Long before I entered that courtyard, long before I have the first stranger on my bed, long before I had my first step that led to my mortification, the Lord already saw me. The Lord knows what I have been through. And that is the same with you, my dear friends. Long before you are experiencing the pain that you are experiencing, long before you're sinning, you have that cherished sin in your heart. Long before you're experiencing or the struggles that you have in life, the Lord already knew, and His gaze is on you. Jesus did not miss anything about you. He's just waiting for you, time and time again, to look back to Him and ask Him to help you out. After a few moments, I regained consciousness. The courtyard atmosphere had changed. It was strangely quiet. I peeked out from under my shriveled hair to see Jesus calmly tracing words in the dust of the temple floor. At first, I couldn't make the words. And I watched as He stood and said, "He who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first." And I cringed. I cringed with what He said. I expect a hail of stone fall on me. But instead, I heard a thud. A thud. Someone walking away. Opening my eyes, I watched as the teacher stooped down again and continued writing. What was he writing? What was the teacher writing at that time? I listened to the whispers of the diminishing crowd, and I learned that the teacher is actually writing the sins of each temple officials. He is writing the sins of everyone who is there in that place. The Lord knows the heart of each person right that time. The Lord can see their sins. The Lord can see their struggles. The Lord can see their pains. They cannot hide anything from the Lord. And the Lord actually can read your heart right now. The Lord can see your pain. The Lord can see your struggles. The Lord can see anything that you're going through. You cannot hide anything from the Lord. He knows your sin, even the darkest sin that you cannot tell even just one person. After a few moments that seemed like eternity, the gentle hand of Jesus touched my shoulder. I brushed my hair from my face and raised my eyes. I saw Jesus looking at me, a prostitute, with infinite compassion and with infinite love. On His face was a slightly quizzical smile, as if He were wondering, why would I be groveling on an undignified manner in this holy place? And so standing slowly, I gazed about me and saw that the scribes and the priests were gone. The hypocrites who had entrapped me fled from the temple. Then Jesus, Oh, Jesus! He is the only one who left there because he is the only one who doesn't have sin. He is the only one who has the right to stay there in front of me. And he might as well throw one rock on me because he is not sinful. He is sinless. But yet, he didn't. And then, he called me. He addressed me with a term of respect and said, "Woman, where are they that accused you? Has no one condemned you?" I looked around, bewildered, and answered him, "No one, Lord, no one," knowing also that he himself would not condemn me. He replied with that look of love and compassion and said to me, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." My heart was melted with his love. It was too good to be true. I am an adulterer, and his only rebuke to me is go and sin no more. It's as if 1,000 or even millions of thorns was removed from my body. Could it be true that I was free to go? I'd been reprieved, rescued from my just punishment. And so I would stop here for a while. I don't want you to remember. I don't want you to forget what Jesus said to me at that time. He said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." There are two phrases that he said. Again, that's "neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." Neither do I condemn you. Is Jesus condoning adultery there? Is Jesus approving or allowing adultery or let's say sin when he said that? Tell me, theologians. Is Jesus condoning adultery there? I believe no, never. He viewed adultery here as a sin. That's why he said, "Go and sin no more." And think about this with me, my dear friends. If God came to accuse us of sin, there wouldn't be enough rocks. Listen, if God came to accuse us of sin, there wouldn't be enough rocks in the world to stone the guilty, nor innocence enough to hurl the stones. There would be too many of us. All of us are condemned because of our sins. And the stones here on earth will never be enough to throw on each and every one of us. And no one would be worthy to throw even one rock, for we have all sinned and have fallen short to the glory of God. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. If condemnation is his reason for coming, if Jesus came here just to condemn us, he doesn't have to come. He didn't have to come. For in the first place, we are already condemned. The second phrase goes, what's the second phrase, everyone? Louder, please. Go and sin no more. Is Jesus asking us to be sinless when he said that? Is Jesus asking us to be sinless when he said that? Jesus can never say anything less. Sin is the disease that is killing me, that is killing all of us. And if Jesus didn't mean that way, what would have Jesus said that time? Go and sin a little less? Go to your movies and watch probably 1 hour only. Go there in Paseo and do whatever you want. Just do it once a week or once a month. Do whatever your sweetheart is doing.
Just do it when nobody sees you. Go and cut back on your life of prostitution. Jesus did not come back to save us in our sin, but from our sin. And we are saved from the three P's of sin. The sin, the penalty of sin, the power of sin, and when he comes back, the presence of sin. And I believe no one here would claim that he is perfect, but the Lord has left us a perfect example. He is the author. He is the one who saved us from our sin, and he is also the finisher. Do you understand that? The finisher of our faith. After being saved from sin, it is he who should work in our behalf and not us working our way towards being like him. Perfection of his character in us is not our work, but his. Brother Michael Dant simply put it this way, only he can do it. Only I can let him. And that is the essence of the gospel, my dear friends. That is righteousness by faith right there. If you continue to say that God can keep me from sinning, we are venturing onto deadly ground. In essence, we are saying the devil is powerful enough to tempt me to sin, but Jesus isn't powerful enough to keep me from sin. 1 John 4:4 says, "Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them. He who is in you is greater than he who is in the world." Man hates the sinner. This is so beautiful. We are a total opposite of who Jesus is. Look, man hates the sinner, but loves the sin. Christ hates the sin, but loves us. Christ hates the sins that we are doing, but he still loves us. And during the time in the courtyard of the temple, my initial instinct was to flee the place as quickly as possible. But I felt constrained by an overpowering gratitude to thank my advocate. Willingly, I threw myself at the feet of Jesus and poured out my heartfelt appreciation at the ground. Then I saw the word adulterer. I saw the word adulterer staring back at me. And before I could seek answers in the face of the gentle teacher, a strong morning breeze came through the temple court, erasing the entire catalog of sins etched on the ground. At that moment, I felt an enormous burden of guilt lift from my soul. Oh, Jesus, you choose to write my sins on the dust. You choose to write our sins on the dust. And I remember the stories I heard from back home. There are three instances that the Lord wrote something with his own fingers. The first one was when he wrote the Ten Commandments on the table of stone. The Ten Commandments written on a table of stone means it can never be erased. It will stand forever. It will stand forever. The second one was the prophecy for the Babylon when the finger of God wrote on the wall of stone, many tickle of our sin. That prophecy became a reality. It was written on a wall of stone. And the third one was when the Lord wrote my sins on the dust. Praise God, our sins are only written on the dust. It can be erased, my dear friends. Praise God, for our sins are only written on the dust. I went home that day, living for joy, and I can't help but sing. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found.
My God, my Savior has ransomed me. That's how I met my one true love. And from that day on, at Jesus' feet has become my favorite place in the world. That day, I learned the definition of love. Love is not a feeling. Love is not a thing. Love is a person, and his name is Jesus. Love is Jesus, my dear friends. And my heart was filled with gratitude for what Jesus did. And some time later, I got my opportunity. I anointed Jesus Christ with fragrant oil that's worth my year's wages, 300 denarii. Yet a year's worth of wages still was not enough. The tears I shed on his feet was still not enough. Everything is not enough for what Jesus did for me. I ask you one question right now, my dear brothers and sisters. What can you give to the Lord for all that he has done to you? What can you give to the Lord for all that he has done to you? I thought I wasn't like Mary Magdalene. I thought I am not an adulterer. I didn't do any probably great sin that is in the eyes of everybody. But you know what? When I looked at the meaning of the name Mary and the meaning of my name, it has the same meaning. Mary and Miriam means rebellion, and both that names came from another name or a place, if you could say, which means Mara, which means bitter. I grew up in a pastor's family. And we have our own share of bitterness in life, and I cannot enumerate them all because of the constraint of time. When I stepped on my third year in high school, I had battled against low self-esteem. I would intentionally go in front of the class so that no one will see me crying, because I thought I am just too ugly, too untalented, not important, and I have no value in life. I always cry. For the longest time, I will cry in front of the class, and I would think bad about myself. I would call my parents, I would tell them, I just want to go home, I don't want to stay here anymore in school. I'm just feeling so desperate in my life. But the most beautiful thing about it is when we had a week of prayer back in my fourth year, I met Jesus, and eventually, I had a relationship with him. We don't have a cell phone back there during that time, and so it's as if the angels and the Holy Spirit would wake up my friend and I early in the morning at 5 a.m., just so we can spend time with the Lord. But still, this battle of low self-esteem lingered in my heart. I went to AUP for college, and every time somebody would be affirmed with what they are doing, I would get jealous. I would think bad of myself. Even during the preparation of this week of prayer, there was a point in my life that I thought, I am just too sinful. I'm just too unworthy to speak in PIC. And that time, I cannot control it anymore. I cried. And I even hyperventilate because I'm crying too much already. I'm looking down at myself. And many times in my life, I had my own share of rebellion. I've been busy with ministry, but nobody knew the sins that I'm doing. I would go back to the dorm and watch my movies. I would go to Instagram and follow people that I shouldn't follow. Nobody knew about that. And every time I am just feeling too sinful to come to God, I thought, Lord, I will not come to you. I have to clean myself up first before I can come to you. I'm just too sinful to be forgiven. And if there are people like me here in this place right now, you are thinking that I have gone too far from the Lord. I am just too sinful to come to Him. I have sunk deeper into the pit of sin. I would like to discourage you right now. There will never be a time that you can clean yourself before you can come to God. We only need a Savior. We only need a Savior. Lift Him up, page 256.6 says, if you feel yourself to be the greatest sinner, if you're feeling right now and you're remembering all the sins that you have done and how much you have tried your best to come to God, but still you have fallen into sin, if you feel yourself to be the greatest sinner, Christ is just what you need, the greatest Savior. If you feel yourself to be the greatest sinner, Christ is just what you need, the greatest Savior. The heart of God yearns over His earthly children with a love stronger than death. In giving up His Son, He has poured to us all heaven in one gift. The Savior's life and death and intercession, the ministry of the angels, the pleading of the Spirit, the Father working above and through all, the unceasing interests of the heavenly beings, all are enlisted in behalf of man's redemption. The Lord is doing everything just for you, my dear friend, just for me to be saved. All eyes are closed. I ask of you right now, please close your eyes and bow your head. Please, everybody, even the faculty and staff, please close your eyes and bow your head and talk to your Savior at this very moment. Only Jesus, please close your eyes, I plead with you. We're not doing any performance here. We're not doing anything. But please just close your eyes and talk to your Savior. All to Jesus He surrendered. Only Christ laid glory down. He left heaven and His Father put aside His royal crown. Only Jesus He surrendered, born of man and yet divine. He was tempted yet triumphant, came to heal your heart and mine. Only Jesus He surrendered, beaten, suffered, crucified. He was holy, pure, and sinless. 'Twas for your life that He died. He surrendered all. He surrendered all. All for you and your salvation. He surrendered all. As a bill singer will be sung, please still close your eyes and talk to the Lord. Ask Him, Lord, what do you have me do? And look at the cross. Look at Him who saved you from your sins.
Where we are lonely.
your eyes are closed and your brows are hid as the music plays. Mary has been there, lonely, alone, too sinful, seemingly for her to be saved. But she is a wonderful Savior. She is a wonderful Christ. And when she experienced that love from the Lord, He didn't hesitate to come to Him. And He abided at the feet of Jesus. He abided there. And Jesus was on the cross. And Jesus raised from the dead. She's the first person to see Jesus. And the same Jesus that Mary has is calling you right now. Whoever it is who wants to give all his or her sins to the Lord and just wants to surrender his life through baptism, the Lord is calling you. He's at the cross calling you. Come to me. Give me your sins. And I'll wash you white as snow. Whoever right now is being inspired by the Holy Spirit to come and surrender his or her life, please come to Jesus and be washed through the waters of baptism. When Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you," the Lord is actually saying, "I will take your penalty because I love you. Sin hurts you and sin hurts me. I will be a sacrifice in your place. Because you love me, go and sin no more." Whoever wants to accept Jesus as their personal Savior, please come to Jesus in front and accept Him as their Savior. Acts 2:38 says, "Then Peter said unto them, Repent, and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost." Once again, whoever wants to accept Jesus as their personal Savior, the one who alone can save us, cleanse us from our sins, I invite you to come. Come in front. Come in front. Come at the feet of Jesus. All eyes are closed. All eyes are closed. Whoever you are, the Lord knows your heart. The Lord can see through what you are going through. He is inviting you to come. Come and accept Him as your personal Savior. We don't know tomorrow, my dear friends. We don't know tomorrow if you will still be alive. And so today, make a commitment, make a decision to come to God and accept Him as your personal Savior. All eyes are closed. It is just between that person and the Lord. Please, I beg you, come. Come to Jesus. He longs to wrap His arms around you, cleanse you from sin, and save you. Please come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. We don't have much time right now, but whoever is impressed by the Lord to come to Jesus, this is your time. Come to Him. Accept Him as your personal Savior through the waters of baptism. Come. Come to Jesus right now. He's longing to see you at His feet. So whoever is still impressed, as we pray, you can come in front and show your commitment to the Lord. But lastly, I just want to make an appeal.
Are you the one who have not forgiven somebody because they have done so much sin against you? Are you like the Pharisees, like those hypocrites who see that you are good? Or rather, you're like Mary, who just want to surrender all the pain, all the sins you're going through. Please stand. And don't just stand because you know me. Don't just stand because you see your friend standing. Stand because you really want to commit your life to God. If there are still people who want to accept Jesus as their personal Savior through baptism, come in front. The Lord is seeing you. Don't just stand because your friends are standing out. Come because you want to really surrender your life to God. Let us all pray. Almighty Father in heaven, I'd like to praise you so much, your Lord, for many times in our lives, we feel as if we have no hope. We feel too sinful. We feel too broken to be made whole. Or probably many of us here feel as if we're just okay, like the Pharisee. But Lord, we praise you for tonight. You have told us that neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. And if there are still people, dear Lord, right now who is being convicted by the Holy Spirit to come and accept you as their personal Savior through the waters of baptism, please hasten their footsteps here in front and show how much they love you. Oh, dear Lord, there is nothing too great for us to surrender compared to what you have done for us. Giving our lives to you is the only list that we can do for what you have done for us. And so, dear Lord, we beg you right now, please take a hold of our lives, take full control of it, and give us power to renounce sin and turn our backs from it. I pray for my friends as well who have decided to be baptized by your grace. Please bless them. And please don't let the devil attack them from now on until the time that they will truly give their lives to you. Please help them commit everything to your hands. Thank you so much, Heavenly Father, for being just the Savior that each one of us need. Thank you. Thank you, for there is hope in Jesus Christ. And we claim that now. We claim that by faith, knowing that you love us so much, and there is nothing that will separate us from that love. Thank you so much, your Lord, for hearing our prayers, and thank you for loving us despite of who we are. Thank you for looking upon us, not on who we are right now, but on what and who we will become in your arms. Thank you, Lord, for everything. Thank you for hearing this prayer, for we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.